year 3000 AD, our Earth's temporal lifespan of 7,000 years came to a close. Our Earth's 1,000-year journey towards the center of the galaxy began. The year is 3999 AD. Our final judgment awaits before we pass through the great filter and reach our destiny.
I saw the future. And in the darkness, a voice said, "Let there be light."
I saw everybody die.
And in the darkness, a voice said, "Let there be light."
I saw the future. I saw everybody die.
And in the darkness, a voice said, "Let there be light."
I saw the future. I saw everybody die.
And in the darkness, a voice said, "Let there be light."
I saw the future. I saw everybody die.
HQ has asked me to announce that we are officially under 10 billion names. The remaining names have been redundantly distributed to everyone's church account. You will each have 100 names to get the temple work done for. We ask that every able-bodied person over 12 years old allot some time during the coming months to do their 100 names. Now, a lot of these names are from languages that came shortly after the Tower of Babel and almost immediately went extinct. While it's not necessary to pronounce these names accurately, it is still a great sign of respect. Don't feel weird. It's something we are all going through. You can ask your local professor in post-Tower of Babel extinct languages to help you. Some of mine include Galamashamana and Gukamashamaku and Manchalanchagancha. Plus, you know, 97 more. Now, I said these names are redundantly given out to decrease the chance of any names going unchecked. But that is not an excuse to slack on your names. With the deadline for the final resurrection approaching, it is more important than ever that every name gets done. If you are partly responsible for someone's name not getting its work done, then you are barring a soul from eternal happiness. Believe me, you do not want that guilt on your conscience. It could terribly impact your final judgment, not to mention theirs.
Good news, dear.
I've booked a temple visit for us in 2 weeks.
I don't want to go.
Look, you already have names distributed to you. We'll figure something out.
Look, the temple doesn't work for me. Those baptism changing rooms with their low walls and tiny towels that make me feel immodest, exposed.
It's just people of the same sex.
That doesn't matter. Exposed is exposed.
Well, you could try reading your scriptures to make you feel better.
The scriptures don't explain the temple. Why can't you just accept that I don't feel the spirit in the same way as you do? The temple's not for me. I shouldn't have to feel ashamed because of it.
What's the point of going anyway? The point is to make sure life-saving ordinances are available to everyone.
Like, why do people on Earth have to perform a baptism for some ghost to get the benefits of it? Or
couldn't spirits from spirit paradise have baptized the spirits in spirit prison?
Why have baptism at all? It's just a bath and an agreement. People can do that all the time.
People need bodies to make an informed agreement. Bodies are how we experience the world.
They already had a body when they were alive. Why can't they remember that? And what's me going underwater going to do for them? How will they experience that?
I always imagined that the other spirits slid into your body while you got baptized for them.
Great. Now I have to worry about spirits feeling me up while I'm taking a ritual bath. That sure fixed my impeding sense of immodesty.
With the final judgment and crossing over approaching, some unbelievers are concerned that we're not going to the celestial kingdom after all, and that our planet is just hurtling towards a giant black hole.
Yes, it's a supermassive black hole. Very dangerous. We could get crushed if we don't make evasive maneuvers quickly. I recommend constructing a network of giant engines. We have little time, so we need to start construction now.
Look, we may not have been alive at the time, but we had this exact same debate with the Earth going outside its orbit and starting its journey. We thought we might need to build dangerous engines, but our Earth was guided by spiritual hands. We thought our climate, weather, and day-night cycles would be ruined, but now instead of a sun and moon in our sky, we have a German thumb orbiting our planet, regulating our heat and light. God has not abandoned us. He found a way then, and he'll find a way now.
I don't know how this Earth's motion started, but at this point it's being pulled in by gravity. Maybe you created engines before but destroyed them, or redirected asteroids to move us.
But we can calculate the movement of the Earth and the orbit of these satellites. But traveling through a black hole is totally different. It's not just impractical, it's physically impossible. There's no conceivable way for a planet to just waltz through a black hole like it's a portal. Aren't you a scientist? Mass warp space-time like fabric. Black holes are so massive that they punch a hole through that fabric, right? Hypothetically. But even if they do, we will be spaghettified and crushed before we make it to the other side. And even if we could, there's no reason to. You say God is on the other side. It's funny. We have stories of people going up mountains to see God. Mountains used to be inaccessible, but they were just close enough to be a comforting, watchful eye. So people put their gods onto mountains. But then people finally scaled mountains. God wasn't there. So God moved to the clouds. But then we created radar, weather balloons, airplanes, and God wasn't there. Then God lived in space, but we made telescopes, and he wasn't there. Some argued he was hiding behind the space dust that shrouds the center of galaxies, but we made better instruments, and he wasn't there. Now he's supposedly beyond space and time on the other side of this black hole. What makes you think this time is going to be any different? We must stop looking for hope in faraway places. We must start relying on ourselves. This global infantilization and self-doubt must end. God will find a way. There's no finding a way. We can't be sure it was really God who put those satellites in our orbit or took us from our sun, because our theocracy controls all the history books. It could have been a grand project of engineering so we could safely escape an expanding sun. Regardless, the truth is we are accelerating towards a black hole, and if we don't do something, we are all gonna die. Some say the heaven is far away, but I feel closer around me as a... Oh, honey, did you hear? Your great-great-grandfather Enos got twinkled yesterday, and at the ripe old age of 600, now he's out ministering and gathering names in the spirit world. It's a pity, though. He always enjoyed being a proxy for anointings, but now his job's changed. I don't see how that's important, on whether he's gathering names or doing them. Yeah, about that, I was thinking you could go see your bishop about your concerns. I already scheduled a meeting with him. You what? Telling an old man about my problems? He'll just give the same cliches that you do, if not more cliche.
I'm trying to understand. If adversity was necessary for free will and Satan was let loose for that purpose, then how come right now in the millennium those rules don't apply anymore? The greatest source of evil is not calamity or demons. It's here, inside our minds. Even if Satan is bound in the millennium by default, it doesn't mean individuals can't let him into themselves. We say the millennium is a time of peace with less misery, but by extension, should there be less happiness?
That's an oversimplification. We still have challenges, we just take them in stride.
So why couldn't people before the millennium take them in stride?
But some did. That's what the church was for.
Then why wasn't the church everywhere to begin with? And with all the contention over religion, it's hard to believe peace was the church's doing. It seems like the only reason for peace now is that there's only one side without opposition.
Look, I don't want to argue. I'm sure we'll find out in the celestial kingdom.
Do you think we could be naked in heaven?
No. That would be a violation of modesty.
But if we're resurrected without carnal thoughts, or at least all those in heaven have the ability to resist or redirect them, then modesty would serve no purpose in mitigating sin. I think that is something we've left behind long ago, along with our innocence. Isn't the purpose of life to overcome sin so we can have what was earlier too dangerous to have, but now with the ability to resist its abuse? It's like that tree of life in the Garden of Eden. The cherubim had to guard it. But if we hold onto the iron rod, then we can eventually return to it. Our life, our fully resurrected body, our true skin.
Do you want to be nude now?
No. Personally, I think I've been too conditioned and traumatized by my own skin since birth. I don't know if I can overcome it. Maybe if there are rehabs in heaven to get used to it again. It seems like we spend so much time avoiding sin that we never learn how to resist it. And you expect us to suddenly be able to resist despite our lack of experience. It seems antithetical to why we're here on Earth. We will always have the ability to either avoid or resist sin. I still find that hard to believe. So how did the meeting go? Ironically, this time it was the bishop who felt sexually uncomfortable.
In the millennium, those who are righteous are resurrected instantly when they die. Sometimes I wonder if I should kill myself to reach resurrection faster. Then again, suicide could downgrade me to evil and I'd have to wait for the final resurrection. Reminds me of an old myth that if someone saw the celestial kingdom, they'd kill themselves to get there. Which doesn't make any sense because the kingdoms only come after the millennium. What would my new body look like? Will it look like how I would have grown up? Just without any disease? How do you even define disease? Could white skin be made black because it has a lower chance of sunburn? No, our religion has taught the opposite, in fact. So many blemishes. The mark of Cain all over me. Or will bodies be what our spirit always wanted them to be? Could I disagree with my spirit? Or will the opinion of myself and my spirit be one by definition? If I change my mind, could my body change? Or am I stuck on a static appearance? Are eternal and unchanging really synonymous? Is perfection the top of a narrow peak, or is it the ability to fly between them? If I have a degree of control over my perfected body's appearance, will people judge me? A rotten spirit choosing a rotten-looking body despite being able to choose any look they want? Will I not want to define my body like a painter leaving their only canvas blank out of indecision? Will people demand that my body have a persistent look and uniqueness so that they could recognize me? Would perfect beings really be hampered by visual recognition? Oh crap, it's an angel. What were you supposed to do in these situations again? Was the angel supposed to have a body but the demon didn't? So you could ask them to shake hands and you'd feel the angel but not the demon? Or was an angel supposed to decline to refuse your hand? Because they're so glorious or something? Then again, if an demon isn't but stupid, he'll probably decline to shake your hand as well.
crap, I should say something before I'm too suspicious.
What are you doing here?
Fear not, my friend. I have chosen you.
Chosen? Would a handshake be in order?
I have no need for the flesh. What I have is pure.
Be gone or something,
demon. A demon. Because I don't have a body. Is that it? Weren't you also a demon at some point? Before you chose to come to life?
Well, I chose to come here. I admit, I choose not to intermingle with magic. But why should I be ashamed because of my choice?
You want us to make the same dumb choice you did.
Does your mind see no nuance? Why should we need bodies to have a place in this universe? Come with me. Let me show you something.
You may have heard that there is no beginning to physical gods, but they're wrong.
I come from before time. You see, your gods are a result of one of ours rebelling. From thenceforth, the physical gods have multiplied like a disease. Few survive. Those who do must consume their children like their fathers. What do you want me to do? Spread our word. Those with knowledge repel the presence of the material god. They may still be saved. Show me everything.
Been leading up to. Your body gives you negative and positive responses to the world around you. Your body forces its wants onto you. Arbitrary desires from flawed organs, from flawed genes, selected by the meaningless suffering of your ancestors. As long as you hold to your body's arbitrary desires, you will never be happy. This isn't what I signed up for. There must be another way. You're only concerned for your body because your brain chemicals are polluting your soul over some imaginary sense of survival. Well, it's what I want, okay? If you give up your body, your wants will change, vanish. You must only go over the tipping point. If you give up your body, your wants will vanish. If you give up your body, your wants will change, vanish. You must only go over the tipping point. Well, why do you care so much? Isn't that wanting? What we have is purer than want. It is efficiency and naturalness. So why would I want efficiency and naturalness?
I see this is not going well. You're right. We are done.
They won't take you back. Not after what you've done for me. You're no Alma the Younger. I don't want anything to do with either of you.
Only 3 minutes to the final resurrection. I feel so terrible. Why? Well, you know, didn't do all the baptisms on my list. Don't feel bad, it's not necessary. But it is necessary. People may never get to heaven because of me. Yes, they will. Oh, did you not realize?
Realize what?
We finished all the pre-millennial baptisms and ordinances some 300 odd years into the millennium. We've just been continuing to do them because some spirits have changed their minds and they'd like to remember getting their ordinances done while they were consenting to it. Really, but my priesthood leader said, oh, he must have been mistaken. What can I say? Leadership roulette. They don't need any training for their position.
So it's all been for nothing?
No. You did a great thing.
So, resurrection is about to happen. What will my new body be like? Nothing's changed.
Well, I guess you were already the way you should be.
The pain, the pleasure, it's all the same. If everything is so perfect, then why does it still feel so wrong?
Maybe my resurrection is incomplete. That has to be it. I suppose the rest of the resurrection will come after our final judgment. It's not even the final judgment, though. We were judged before. People destined for celestial and terrestrial glory get included in the first resurrection, and people destined for celestial or outer darkness get resurrected in the final resurrection. Being a person born at the end of the millennium, I don't know if this resurrection was part of the first or the last. Honey, you're not destined for the bottom. And I'm sure that first and final resurrection glory designation is just where you would go, given that you don't change the judge's mind in your final judgment. Otherwise, it wouldn't be a final judgment. And hey, even if it is, you know, you're resurrected towards the very end, so you don't know which one you are, so you have freedom. Just because I'm ignorant of my predestination doesn't mean I'm not predestined.
Hey, mister, get in.
Is
Mr. Inkeduke, don't you remember me? I was baptized in your name.
I baptized him in
Jesus. I baptized him first. That's what really counts.
Baptized you, didn't I? You at least came to my baptism, right?
I'm sorry, I didn't go to your baptism in my name. I already got it done, and I was busy.
Ha! Take that, you useless double baptizer.
I am coming at you live from the Kiramati Line Islands, where the final judgment is officially started. Prosecuting humanity is Satan, Lucifer. On the defense, we have Jesus Christ. For the judges, we have Heavenly Father, Heavenly Mother, and all the figureheads of the seven dispensations. We have Adam, the originator and base model of all humanity. We have Enoch.
Don't all clap at once.
Noah. Abraham.
Just say the word and I'll do it.
Moses. King David.
And Joseph Smith.
Don't fuck us up.
Can begin, we must get our final judge.
What judge?
Freaky.
Now let the trial begin. So look, you understand that if people are prepared for sin, they are given a little leeway in their judgment. Correspondingly, those who are more prepared for sin are judged more harshly. You were born in the millennium, the greatest time to deflect sin.
Could one argue the other way around? That the millennium deprived me of adversity to allow me to exercise my ability to resist sin?
But you don't believe in the power of adversity, do you?
What only kills you, makes you stronger, is a lie, you say.
That scars run deep. And trauma festers. If there's good, it's because healing makes you stronger, not being hurt. And the lack of hindsight and denial of missed opportunity makes us pretend things are better off than if we were never hurt to begin with. That's what you believe, is it not?
Human mind is driven to defend from threats. If there isn't one, they'll make one up.
Forever playing the victim card.
You knew that. You just had to reach out and we would have eased your pain. But you were the very thing I was scared of. A unified force will never make everyone feel safe. And you should understand my reluctance to trust someone who says all my fears are imaginary.
He has too much self-pity to belong in any of the kingdoms. It is for his well-being that he is left out.
Oh, my boy, back from judgment. So, the verdict?
Outer darkness.
I'm so sorry. I'll promise to ride your call, or whatever the equivalent is with celestial telecommunication technology.
I'm afraid that will be against regulation.
Really? Just like that, you'll leave me to darkness? Sorry, but I don't have a choice in the matter. But you do. Come with me. I can still be your son. I'm sorry. You're but one person. I have great plans laid for me in the eternity. I'll be a goddess. Don't ask me to give up thousands of my future children for one child. Don't ask me to give up my faith for you. You can't win. I see how it is. Goodbye.
So quiet in the dark, it always feels so stark how silence grows under the moon, and it's always gone so soon. I used to think that I was bold, I used to think love was for fun. Now all my stories have been told, except for one. As the stars start to align, I hope you take it as a sign that you'll be okay. Everything will be okay. And if the seven hells collapse, although the day will be my last, you will be okay. When I'm gone, you'll be okay. If the stars ever align, I hope you take it as a sign that you'll be okay. Everything will be okay. And if the seven hells collapse, although the day will be my last, you will be okay. When I'm gone, you'll be okay. And if the ground, I know you'll hear the trumpet sound and you'll be okay. Everything will be okay. And when creation goes to die, you can find me in the sky upon the last day.
Outer darkness, a place of refuge from the demiurge's wrath. What do you want? The linear afterlife system never made much sense. Contradictory preferences are the only evil. Morality is relative. Preferences are the source of all conflict. People want things, and they contradict. People say misery creates happiness. But likewise, happiness creates misery. A desire to reach the high again. Desire is the source of suffering. You only need to give up your desire to be free. Believe me, I've tried asceticism. It's not possible. Which is why I'm not suggesting that. Your body is the source of your desire. Give up your body. In death, there is peace. After all, better dead clean than alive unclean, as they would say. No, you have your arbitrary need for conformity. I have my arbitrary need for novelty. I may not know the reason yet, but I will oppose you. I will outlive my enemies. I will continue to have what you don't.